welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. At the end of World War II, my father used to say he was told, who he had been a lieutenant commander in the Navy, don't throw your uniform away because you're going to need it in the next war very quickly. Well, my guest today, Richard Reeves, has written Daring Young Men, The Heroism and Triumph of the Berlin Airlift, June 1948 to May 1949. It's published by Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Richard.
Thank you, Connie.
Richard Reeves is known for presidents, not for writing about war.
Right. I've run out of presidents, I guess. No, I wanted to try my hand at a kind of adventure story, but I wanted it to be about what I thought when I was growing up America was, what kind of people we were, what kind of country we were. And it was really, a lot of it had to do with Abu Ghraib and that, and the business of torture. And I've lived a lot of places in the world and in my job get around.
Yeah.
And I couldn't, you know, it hurt. I mean, the hatred that there was for America, for the preemptive invasions, for pushing people around, for totally misunderstanding their cultures. And I wanted to find a story when America was guided by its better angels, as Lincoln said, and the airlift fit that. Yeah. The airlift was a heroic thing done by people who were trying to do good and who much preferred feeding the people than killing them.
Richard, let's set the scene, though. At the end of World War II, Berlin was now divided into four parts.
Right.
The Russian, the United States of America, Britain, and France. We were the only ones who the Germans had not invaded our country. So I think that the Americans had a more generous spirit towards how they were being encapsulated by the Russians.
I think that's totally true, and that we had the Russians, after all, there probably was hardly a Russian soldier whose family had not been damaged in some way by the Nazis. The French hated them at least as much. They were an occupied country.
Twice.
The British weren't. The British were a little better. They were very correct.
Yeah.
And we sent our kids over there for the occupier. All they saw were hungry women, crippled people, sick children, and they just didn't have that visceral hatred for Germans that the others did.
Joseph Stalin now looks at it, and he is the great big brown bear. He wants to take it over and make everyone miserable. And he's talking about there'll be one Russian currency.
Right.
That was sort of the stick that started this whole thing.
Well, Stalin, who ordered it, made up his mind in March of 1948 that he was going to have the East Germans attempt and the Russians attempt to drive out the Allies. And then in June of the same year, we had made a big mistake at the end of the war in Germany. That is, we had given the Russians copies of the plates to print Reichsmarks, the old Hitler currency, actually. And he kept printing and printing because Soviet troops had never been paid during the war. So they were being paid in Eastern European currencies, which were mostly worthless. And we then secretly brought in a new currency, Deutschmarks. And on June 24th, when we announced that we were going to use the new currency, the Russians, who had a million soldiers around Berlin, because it was in the middle of the Eastern Zone, they closed all the land routes, all the water routes, all the rail lines into the city. The one thing they couldn't stop was planes, not because we had figured this out, but because international air safety standards were such that there had to be lanes into the city, and we were assigned, the three allies were assigned three corridors coming in. Not that we had the planes or the men, to bring in enough to feed 2 million people, but there was at least technically a way to do it.
Well, what's interesting is Harry Truman is president. He has advisors who say, forget it, let's get out of there, let's not do it. And he, you know, it's the epitome of the poker player. He really played poker through this whole thing, holding his cards.
All right. Well, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, which were headed by a hero, Omar Bradley, the State Department by General George Marshall, the chiefs, the new National Security Council, and the cabinet all voted unanimously against doing any about staying in Berlin, not because they were it wasn't political, it was logistical. They didn't think it was possible to feed that many people, keep them alive, keep them warm, give them electricity, or at least a little bit of it. They just thought it was impossible. And Robert Lovett, one of the wise men who was in that room that day, said, you know, Mr. President, all the Russians need to overrun Berlin is shoes. And Truman never said anything through the whole meeting. After they all voted, he said, we're staying in Berlin, period. And then Lovett said, but Mr. President, have you thought about this? And Truman got up and walked out of the room. And we had a Berlin airlift.
And he said, get those planes. And they called the
The first were C-47s, yeah, of which we had only 37 in Germany, DC-3s, built here in Santa Monica. But by that time, they were war-weary. A lot of them were out in the desert in Arizona already. As one British pilot said, that they were piles of parts flying in a loose formation. And they were. The flying was incredibly dangerous because these planes were carrying three times the normal load, and they were being used five or six times as much as normal. So the whole thing was balanced on a cliff through the thing. And then we brought in C-54s, four DC-4s, from Douglas, all over the world.
From Douglas, I guess.
From Douglas aircraft,
the
right.
Four.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the and they carried 10 tons. And in the end, we used 350 of them, plus the British used 200 of their planes, so that a plane took off and landed at each of the three airports in Berlin every 45 seconds for a year.
And all of these guys who had been in the service, who
right.
thought, who was starting up a normal life, including one who was on his way where to Hawaii with his wife, who was pregnant, called, get back to Germany, go to, well, where's it, Boston, outside there, fly from there to Germany.
Right.